This is not just the place where the world's best tech gets unveiled. It's where visionary ideas come to life. Because it's not enough to create amazing things. You have to create things that make a meaningful difference with people. Real people. Because they're the ones who decide what's worth talking about. What's ready for reality. It's tech that allows us to connect and explore and play in ways we can see and ways we haven't begun to imagine and here, right now is where we'll discover the ideas that will change our lives for the better. Are you ready?
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Senior Vice President of Marketing and Communications at the Consumer Technology Association, Gene Foster.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to CES 2020. I hope you're all enjoying day one. For some of us, it's quite a surprise that it is only day one. We've been here for some time to get set up, but so far we're having a great show and we hope you will too. At the Consumer Technology Association, we believe very strongly that the tech industry has an important role to play in addressing some of the world's most pressing challenges, be them in healthcare, jobs, climate, the environment, or helping disadvantaged communities. This morning, on the CES keynote stage, our President and CEO, Gary Shapiro, announced that CES is partnering with the World Bank, and we've actually launched a global tech challenge to the entire world. We kicked off with our first challenge, which is in healthcare, addressing some health challenges in East Africa, and we're going to be following up with additional challenges in the next few months, addressing climate and also addressing gender disadvantagement. So we're very passionate about that in the tech industry and the role the tech industry will play. But we also believe that brands have an important role to play in helping address those challenges. And C-Space at CES is the home for brands. Every year we bring over 30,000 marketers, advertisers, and brand leaders to here, to C-Space in the area, to address some of those tech issues. Today we're going to be introducing some of those great brands on stage that will be looking at the role that brands play in doing good. And those brands also know that doing good is good for business. To introduce those brands, please welcome me in joining MediaLink founder, CEO, and chairman, Michael Kasson.
Thank you, Gene, and good afternoon. As we kick off a new decade, it's clear that purpose has become much more than a buzzword for modern companies that want to succeed. Purpose is gaining urgent momentum, primarily because consumers are demanding it. A recent Accenture study revealed that 63% of global consumers prefer to purchase products and services from companies that stand for something meaningful. Another study from Omnicom's Porter Novelli indicated that 66% of consumers are willing to actually switch from a brand they know to an unknown purpose-driven brand. So the jury is in. Purpose has become a non-negotiable baseline for how to do business. And an event like CES, with a focus on technology, electronics, and media, we get a snapshot of what real global change can look like. We can learn how successful leaders embrace innovation and change while holding tight to responsibility and purpose. I'm excited to introduce two leaders who understand the deep responsibilities of the companies they lead, which enables them to serve the various constituencies, which include, obviously, their customers, their partners, their employees, their communities, and the world at large. They also inherently respect the role of technology when applied properly to achieve these goals. Alan Jope, who was appointed CEO of Unilever at the start of last year, is leading a company that's demonstrating the positive impact of operating sustainably. The proof in this case really is in the pudding. Last year, it was shared that Unilever's sustainable living brands are growing faster than its other brands. Mark Benioff, the chairman and co-CEO of Salesforce, has spent the better part of two decades living the ideal of doing well by doing good. Whether bringing a corporate tax to combat homelessness or backing a corporate tax to combat homelessness or making investment decisions based on the inclusivity of local policies, Salesforce has become a true trailblazer when it comes to business activism. I'm delighted to welcome both Alan and Mark to the stage and discuss how their companies have embraced a philosophy of purpose, and to learn more about the hopes they have for technological innovation to make our world a better place to live in. Mark and Alan, please join me. So, first of all, Mark, it's good to welcome you back to the stage at CES. We did this 7 years ago. Wow. I think I did the math.
How was it?
It was great. It was good for me. How about for you?
What?
I said it was good for me.
How about for you? That was memorable, Michael.
There you go. Both of you embody what I said in the opening remarks about dedication. And that dedication to purpose has actually been closely tied to the success of your respective businesses. What I'd like to do is really kind of dive into the link between societal and business progress and why it's so essential that these two things coincide. Mark, starting with you, how does the purpose help you prioritize what you do, the decisions you need to make?
Well, for us, I mean, it really started now almost 21 years ago, and the best decision I ever made was the day we started Salesforce. We put 1% of our equity, our profit, and our time into a charity, a nonprofit organization. And that was very easy at the time because we had no equity, we had no profit, we had no employees. But today, of course, Salesforce has about 50,000 people. We'll do about $17 billion in revenue. We have about $175 billion market cap. So that idea that Salesforce scaled, because we put at the beginning the seed of giving back, then we have been able to do 4 million hours of volunteerism. We've been able to give back hundreds of millions of dollars in grants back to our community. We run 40,000 nonprofits and NGOs for free on our service. That right from the beginning, that's why we did it. We didn't just do it to build another software company or to do it one more time. That wasn't really what it was about. It was to really scale it and do it the right way. And to realize that in today's world, that we could build a company that wasn't just about shareholders, but about all stakeholders. And that is what we have very much ended up with.
Well, and Mark, Salesforce consistently has ranked at the top of best places to work. Wherever I read those various rankings, Salesforce is always at the top of that list. So that's actually been an enhancement to people to want to work at Salesforce.
And the funny thing, Michael, is that, you know, it's very simple that for many years, we were not on those lists. We were not ranked as best place to work. And I would call the various people doing those surveys and so forth and other tech companies and so forth that ranked highly. And I'm like, well, why are they ranked so highly? What is it that they're doing that their employees love? And they said, look, these companies, they provide free food.
And ping pong.
And kitchens and five-star chefs. And you just don't do that. You're just not into that. You're just into this whole volunteerism thing, and you're into, you know, you're going to have this narrative, trust is your highest priority, and giving back, and that's, you know, that's great, but really, if you could have a kitchen and a restaurant, then you could really get in there. And I'm like, that's not where we're going with our resources. So the funny thing is the world changed. And I don't know exactly when the world changed. You might know. And all of a sudden, we started moving up these lists until, you know, we were consistently number one, best place to work, best place to work. And then when they polled these employees, well, why is it that Salesforce is number one? Well, we like the culture. We are there not just to make money, but to give back. And the funny thing is, you know, I started Salesforce in 1999, March 8th of 1999, because when I was at Oracle, you know, I felt very much split in my personality. I mean, this is why I wrote the book Trailblazer. I felt very much split. During the day, I was making, you know, software, selling it, you know, to great companies like Unilever and so forth. But then I had a philanthropic side, and then I was working in schools and all that. And somehow by, you know, I won't give you the, you haven't read the book yet, but when you do, I don't want to give it away to you, Michael, but, you know, I had a revelation that we can do both. This is about the power of and. You don't have to make a decision that you're going to be philanthropic and business-oriented, that that's a false choice. That businesses can be a platform for change, that business can be the greatest platform for change, that you can orient your values in a way that you can transform as your company scales, and that companies today have an obligation to take care of the communities that they are in. So for example, in San Francisco, you know, we have adopted the local public school district. I've adopted a public school. Every CEO in our country needs to adopt a public school. We have to be more dedicated to the kids that are coming up. The first time I went to CES, I was 16. I was writing video games when I was 15, 16, 17 years old, and I went to public schools. That's also where I learned about how to write software. This is also what needs to happen today, and it's very important to me at Salesforce that we're supporting our public schools, our public hospitals, that we're taking care of our homeless, which is a huge crisis. Where I am in San Francisco, we have a tremendous crisis of inequality that we've been battling. And Salesforce has to be a part of it. You know, as the biggest tech company now in San Francisco somehow, we now have to look back and go, yes, this is our responsibility, that we have a responsibility to all of our stakeholders, not just our shareholders. Look, our shareholders have done fine, Michael.
They've done fine.
A 3,500 or 4,000% return since we went public, you know, in 2004. Shareholder return, we have that. But we also have a stakeholder return. So when I think about things like those nonprofits and NGOs are running, the kids in those schools, the hundred millions of dollars that we're giving away to nonprofits, those have to be measured as the stakeholder return. By the way, the planet is a key stakeholder. We're a net zero company. We have to take care of the planet. We can see that the planet is on fire. We have to be carbon neutral. We have to pay attention to not just the emissions that are coming for our company, but also innovative way to sequester the carbon that has been emitted since the first industrial revolution, because all stakeholders have to matter to us, not just our shareholders. And by the way, this is good business. You can see this is one of the reasons that Salesforce has become a high-performance company. This is the markings of a modern high-performance culture today.
Well, and Mark, you talked about trust. I remember sitting on this stage at the other theater 7 years ago, and we talked about trust then. I flip over to Alan, and I say, I've been fortunate to participate with Unilever from the very day I started MediaLink. As you know, Unilever was our number one.
I thought you were going to say from the day Unilever started in 1860.
Yeah, I'm that old. But we've been able to participate in the digital transformation, yep, at the same time participate and watch the purpose-driven transformation of a company. And it's been extraordinary, Alan. You're obviously celebrating a year plus in the CEO role, but you've been with Unilever, as I recall, for 36 years, if I'm not mistaken on my math, or pretty damn close. Okay. So you've been there for your entire career, basically.
I think a lot of the things that Mark mentioned, we could not agree more with. Our business, when it was founded in the mid-1800s, the original founder. He brought in great chefs, had fantastic food for the people, and really the culture has been fantastic ever since then. No, we started our business, Unilever started by this guy, Lord Leverhulme, and he described the purpose of the company as to make cleanliness commonplace and lessen the load for women. When his workers were trying to find housing, he built them a model village. When the First World War broke out and his workers went off to fight in the First World War, not only did he hold their jobs open for them, he paid their wages to their families throughout the whole period they were off fighting. And so we've got a kind of 100 years of DNA that encourages us to do the right thing for multiple stakeholders, for the planet, for society. I think if there is one reason for the enduring success of Unilever, it's the trust that we built up with multiple stakeholders by having a model that shows that we care about things beyond profit.
So this is really a question to both of you. I was taught that one is known by the company they keep. I feel fortunate to be keeping this company up here, but the two of you as CEOs, Unilever and Salesforce, have done extraordinary work together. Was the impetus for that, and it's an interesting question, I guess, since I'm asking it, I think it's an interesting question. The impetus to that was obviously the technology that Salesforce was able to bring to bear, but it was also that Unilever, in my experience, was interested in doing business with companies that had shared beliefs and the kind of partnerships you've built. They aren't just about the dollars and cents. They're obviously, we're all in this business, we're all in business to make a profit. That is true. But you guys, there's something that was underlying the Unilever Salesforce relationship from the inception.
I have a view on that. I think we started working together 6 or 7 years ago because Salesforce is a fantastic technology company. That's why we started working together. And today, pretty much every element of our customer platform and our employee experience is run based on Salesforce technology. And so that shows how important Salesforce is to Unilever. But let me give one little story, which is if food waste was a country, so the food that is produced and never consumed was a country, it would have the CO2 emissions of the third biggest country in the world after the US and China. And we as a food business take that quite seriously. And we were trying to figure out, how do we connect wasted food to these fantastic food banks that exist around the world? And Mark and his team stepped up and said, we can help with that. And sort of reflexively threw resource at it. I think there was no commercial case for either of us. It turned into a very successful project, and we're helping solve a little bit of food waste. So originally, I think we started working with Salesforce because such a great tech company, but the depth of relationship has become more based on values.
So I want to go back to trust. When Mark began the creation of the Marketing Cloud, what is that, about 8, 9 years ago, Mark? Mm-hmm. 10 years ago? We were at that point where trust in marketing had dissipated. It was at an all-time low. Mm-hmm. And we talked about it back then. Mm-hmm. I want to bring that trust into this conversation because mm-hmm. I think today mm-hmm. the consumer, the stakeholders, mm-hmm. they want to do business with companies that they can trust, but they want to trust the values as well as, gee, if I say I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it. They want to trust the values. They want to be able to identify what I said in my opening is people will now choose to do business, I believe, consumers will choose to do business with companies that satisfy and tick that box, not necessarily in lieu of being able to deliver the services or products, but that plays a significant role. And trust was really at the basis of that. And I think that was part of your motivation when you talked about it, even back then.
Well, you're right. You're remembering this correctly. I mean, trust is our highest value in our company. For us, there's nothing more important to us than trust. Of course, there's many things that are important to a corporation. Growth, customer success, innovation, the equality of every human being, the sustainability of our planet. These are all core values of many companies, but nothing is more important than trust. I think for CEOs today, and you kind of hear it in the story of the beginnings of Unilever, or the beginnings of Salesforce, but it's really true for companies today, and when I'm mentoring new CEOs, I say the first thing is you need to ask yourself, what is your highest value? What is the most important thing to you? You know? And for some CEOs, trust is not their highest value. And we all have stories, and we all know people, and Alan and I know people, where those CEOs, trust is not their highest value. And in the technology industry, there's CEOs, for example, who will say, well, actually, Mark, and I write about this in the book, so I'm not going to spoil it for you. Our highest value actually is the best idea wins. The best idea is the most important thing in our company. Nothing is more important than the innovation and the technology, and that's the most important thing for us. Well, that could turn into a huge crisis for you. And as an example, I have there's stories where CEOs are not valuing the equality of their employees. So, for example, female employees, women, gender equality, the importance that we have to pay men and women equally for equal work. I mean, this is a panel with all men, not a great example, I think, actually, in 2020. It does not reflect, you know, the kind of importance that we've put on gender parity, the importance of bringing women into the top positions in our companies, in our industries, but it all starts at pay equality. Are we paying men and women equally? At Salesforce, we've made now adjustments each year over 4 years, $10 million so far, to make sure that we're making pay equality happen. Now, why? People always say to me, now, why is it that you keep having every year you have to make another adjustment? Well, we've actually done about 50 or 60 acquisitions in Salesforce. We have innovated organically and inorganically. But when you buy a company, you not only buy the technology, you not only buy the culture, the brand, you also buy the pay scales. And let me tell you, there's a lot of subconscious bias, and there's a lot of men, when they're hiring women, that they're paying women less than men. And when they're coming into Salesforce, we're going to rationalize that. We're going to look at that and say, are we paying men and women equally? Are we going to have gender equality? The World Economic Forum, where I'm going in about a week, has done some very good research that says it's still going to take more than 100 years before men and women are paid equally for equal work. That is just unacceptable in today's world. And when I talked about key stakeholders, like the school children in San Francisco and the homeless, the planet, let me tell you, one of the key stakeholders for my company is our female employees. I need to make sure that we're taking care of them as well. And that needs an extra eye. Go ahead.
No, I just build out that thought. We're very proud that we've now reached a point where half our non-executive board is women, half our non-executive board is men. We have 12, 6, and 6. We now had a position just at the end of last year where 50% of our management around the world is women and 50% is men. We're exactly gender balanced. I happen to know the data for the UK where we have a gender pay gap, which is that women earn 3% more than men. So we got to tackle that one right away. Just to bring us back to technology, the next group, we continue to have areas, of course, where we need to work on better representation of women, particularly in senior roles in our company. The next area we're looking at right now is people with disabilities, where we've said we want to become the number one employer of choice for people with disabilities. And we want 5% of our workforce to be declared, self-declared, as having a disability. Yes. It's not something people find easy to declare in many instances. Mm. And you know what the biggest two drivers for bringing in people with disabilities are going to be? Culture, the culture of feeling included, and inclusion in the form of technology. So when we talk about accessibility for people with disabilities, it's not about wheelchair ramps and lifts with low-down buttons. It's about technology that allows people who are visual impaired or hearing impaired or of dexterous issues to full access, and technology is going to play a huge role. We have, just give one story, we've brought in 52 people in our Egyptian business who have no, who are visually impaired. And we brought them into the telesales department. And it turns out they dramatically outperform their able-bodied counterparts, because if you're blind, I guess you become a good listener and highly empathetic to your customers. And so we, once again, like all valuable initiatives around purpose and sustainability, this is enlightened self-interest. It's only good because it's sustainable, because it's good for our business. So that's another area of inclusion where I think technology is going to have a huge role to play.
And let me ask a question, because we're talking about technology. We're in that moment where the buzzword is purpose. And as I say, both of you embody more than the buzzword. You actually, as I was taught, don't read people's lips, watch their feet. You both represent people who say the things that you're committed to and actually do them, and that's critically important. But we're hearing about transformation on a regular basis today. Companies that need digital transformation. I'm not sure you need to modify it with digital anymore, but transformation. The transformation that technology can enable isn't just in work process, it is in purpose. It is in making it a better environment for people to work in and the outreach to the community. Mm-hmm. Are there any particular anecdotes that you can talk about where that has, you talked about the food and Salesforce stepping up and bringing the technology to be able to match it with the food banks. There's a great example. Are there others that you could point to that have actually driven the business of Unilever, or in your case, the business of Salesforce?
Mark?
Well, I think that when we talk about digital transformation, for us, every digital transformation begins and ends with the customer. I guess, you know, we made a couple good decisions when we started Salesforce 21 years ago. I mentioned one is our core values, that we picked values that eventually aligned with the future. I think the other thing that we probably did was we picked one word to focus on, which is customer. You know, we don't, there's a lot of things you can do in the technology industry. You have a lot of choices of products you can build. For us, we only build customer products, helping you to connect with your customers in new ways and helping to connect customers and companies together in new ways. That's our sole focus. When I look at the opportunity today, and you know, I love coming to the show because I'm walking the show, but one of the things, one of our customers has a tremendous booth and introduced some amazing products today, which is Audi. I was so impressed seeing the new e-tron, also the next generation, highly sustainable vehicles, the sustainability of their supply chain, how they're going to green all of their products, but also how they're connected to their customers in new ways. On my phone, I have an Audi op, so that basically I drive an e-tron, the e-tron that I have shows up, I'm on a set of journeys with Audi, a onboarding journey, so I can learn how to drive this type of a car. Also, a journey that gives me the connectivity with the dealers to give me my service support, making sure that I'm taking care of the car correctly, and also connecting me with other drivers and helping me build community with other people who also have this same e-tron car. The car really is becoming more of my friend. I have a relationship with the car. It sounds crazy, but it's true. But I also have a relationship with the dealer. I have a relationship with other drivers. That is what is helping the technology do for me. I'm helping to get connected in a new way. That's how I see really the future of mobility itself.
It's interesting because years ago I had a conversation with some of the folks at Unilever in the earliest days of social media. And the question was, do we need to pay attention? This was a dozen years ago. Do we need to pay attention to this space? And I said, well, my answer is yes, but let me tell you why my answer is yes. I was trained that when I started my career as a lawyer, if you had a choice, just putting it in the right time frame, of using your feet, your fax, or your phone. There was no email, there was no other way to communicate. Use your feet, try and get in front of the client, have that direct interaction. So my answer about social media then was that connectivity. Your ability at Unilever back then to speak to the 2 billion people a day that touch a Unilever product, I think that number is close to $2 billion a day now. You can communicate, and to Mark's point about creating that relationship, all of a sudden it's a two-way conversation, both when there's good news and bad news.
So to the question of can technology help put purpose at the center of our business, I think one way to think about that is pick the big problem of the day. Climate change, inequality, social injustice, lack of opportunities for women, deforestation. Pick one, and I'll give you an example of how Unilever is having an impact. Take one, maybe I'll pick a controversial one. So deforestation is a massive contributor and also part of the solution to climate change.
Absolutely.
One of the most important materials that we use is palm oil. Mm. Now, palm oil is becoming a demonized material, which is ridiculous. Palm oil uses 1/9 of the land that equivalents like soy or rapeseed use. Palm oil has got a very good nutritional profile. And the world would be a hungrier place without palm oil. Mm. The problem is when concessionaires, owners of forest, cut down forest to grow palm oil or destroy high-value peatland. Now, the way around that right now is certification. So you go in, you physically audit the concession, you physically audit the smallholder, you look at their practices, and they either are sustainable or not on that day. Who knows what happens the following week, the following month. So we're now buying 100% sustainable certified palm oil. Do I believe it all comes from highly responsible growers? No, I don't. No. Technology is the solution. We're now working on a solution where you have the power of the eye in the sky, so real-time photography, digital image manipulation, massive amounts of data being processed, and the cell phones of the truckers who are picking up the palm fruits. And now we are moving into a prototype where we get real-time, always-on technology to ensure that the suppliers we're buying our palm oil from are not burning down virgin rainforest. You want another example? Social inequality, opportunities for women. In all of these, technology is bringing massive, massive impacts for the good of the planet and the good of society.
Yeah, I'd like to just continue with this story because I actually think that example is a powerful example and a message for all CEOs. I have not really had an opportunity to speak to a CEO in, I would say, the last year that doesn't have a story exactly like this where there is a focus on building a fully sustainable supply chain. I said, Audi's one example. Here's another example with Unilever. What is Unilever doing to making sure that every product they have has a fully sustainable supply chain? Because when that consumer, buys that product at the end of the supply chain, there is going to be a QR code, and they're going to say, now show me exactly how was this product made? And bam, on your phone, it is a story where you're going to see, well, show me that truck that delivered this product, and where did that fuel come from? And that distribution house, and how was that refrigeration done? And by the all the way back to exactly what he said, where we talk about deforestation as a critical part of global warming. We saw the research from a scientist in Zurich that got published in April of last year named Crowther. It's been published in Scientific American and many other journals that said that because we have probably 200 to 300 gigatons of carbon in our atmosphere that we don't want there. One way to sequester that carbon, which would help stop global warming, is more trees. We don't want farmers cutting down those trees. What we want is 1 trillion more trees. We have 3 trillion trees on the planet right now. We want 1 trillion more trees. If we had that, we would sequester 200 gigatons of carbon. It's the opposite of what's happening if somebody's cutting down the trees for palm oil. So what are we going to do? We have to skill those workers, you know, and certify all the way to that point when that consumer does buy that product at the store. They're going to see that farmer has taken that Unilever class on deforestation, on climate change, on the criticality of maintaining the forest, and that it's built into the product. Now, why that's relevant today is if we have having this interview, well, like we did, what did you say, seven years ago? I go back and look at it. I'm confident. Maybe we talked about values. Maybe we talked about trust. Maybe we talked about giving back. But the concept of deeply integrating sustainability into our supply chains was not in the conversation. But today, for a modern CEO of a great company like Unilever, like Alan is, that has to be a key part of their strategy going forward. And many of the companies that are at the show today, you'll see that sustainability is a critical part of what they're doing going forward. And reforestation, especially at a global level with a trillion trees, that has to be part of it, but it has to be deeply integrated into the products and customer stories.
So Mark, I want to not misquote you, but I think you've said, you know, technology is in and of itself not inherently good or bad. It's what happens with it. It's what you do with it.
Well, technology has never been good or bad. The history of mankind, we can look back and say technology is never good or bad. It's what you do with it that matters. But that is true for your life. That is true for your business. Business is the greatest platform for change. Look at what Unilever and what Alan can do. Look at what all of us can do with our businesses. Are you using your business as a platform for change? Businesses are also not good or bad, but there are some businesses that are good and some businesses that are bad. But business has to be a platform for change. We are in a world today when we can see that we have issues. Alan has articulated beautifully so many of the world's issues. Our businesses have to be platforms for change, but each one of us in our hearts, we have to find our own answers on how we're going to be our own platform for change. We all have a role that we have to play in bringing that message forward and kind of helping to kind of create this world and also solve some of the problems that we're talking about.
So generally speaking, the topics we've talked about are, I guess I really can't say it this way, are not controversial, because they are. There are certain parts of these discussions that are very controversial. But in your position as a CEO of, you know, very large, important public companies, do you find yourself at odds ever with your stakeholders or shareholders for that being too central to what you're doing?
Honestly, hardly ever. So one of my misconceptions coming in as a rookie chief exec was that the shareholder base, Wall Street, the City of London would be saying, show me the next quarter, show me the next quarter. And of course they want to see that. But each and every one of our quality investors has also said, take the long-term view. Run the business for long-term success. And you will become irrelevant as a company unless you conduct yourself properly. It's that simple. People will vote with their dollars in the same way as us as a customer. You know, as we look at the tech companies that we want to work with, we look at three levels of responsibility: responsible platforms, responsible content, and responsible infrastructure. And if we can see a company that doesn't seem to give a damn about the content that's on their platform, that doesn't seem to police the content, and that's not worried about viewability, verification, measurability, and impact, we'll move our dollars somewhere else. And so behaving in a responsible fashion is a matter of business survival. And we firmly believe this is not a good thing we're doing. It's our only way of running our company for long-term success.
You, as a CEO, you are going to be given, as all of us are as human beings, choices that we can make. And let me tell you a story. A few years ago, we got a phone call from our employees in Indiana. And our employees in Indiana said that the governor, Mike Pence, who is a friend of mine in the office there, was going to sign a law that was going to discriminate against the LGBT community in Indiana. And, you know, I'm fourth generation San Franciscan. So when you call me and tell me that there's a law being passed to discriminate against the LGBT community, and I'm like, you know, sitting in the home of gay rights, it was not, I didn't really think it's possible, actually. And in fact, that's what I told our employees. It's not possible. Nobody's going to sign a law discriminating against LGBTQ. And they said, no. And so I wrote a letter to him. Hey, Mike, you know, we are the biggest tech employer in Indiana. You know, this is not for our good, for our employees, or even our bringing our customers there, or other things we're doing in Indiana. You don't want to really sign that law and so forth. And then they called me and they said, well, he signed that law. And there's now a law in the books and actions are happening. And it was late at night. I was driving home. I had a driver. I probably had a couple glasses of wine. I don't know exactly what happened. And I tweeted, social media. Yeah, you know, Alan knows, he's been out late with me. And I tweeted, well, we're forced to reduce our investment in the state of Indiana if they're not going to fully support the rights of the LGBTQ community, because Salesforce stands for the equality of every human being. And that was a test of our core values, because we're just standing for our employees, for equality. That is what we're doing. And I didn't realize that was going to turn into something. And it did. The next day, hundreds of other companies said the same thing, that they were also be forced. Mike called me. I was working out in the gym. Mike calls me on my cell phone. Mark, I'm like, hey, how's it going? Good. He's like, look, do you know about this? What's going on? I'm like, what's going on with that law? And he's like, what do you think is going to happen? I said, Mike, I think there's going to be rolling economic consequences against the state of Indiana. He's like, well, what does that mean? It's like, Mike, I don't know, actually. But I think we should change the law, and I will work with you, and we can do it together, and I will get on the plane with our employees, and we will negotiate, resolve this for you. And we did. We went out there, and we had a good conversation. Our employees negotiated a change to the law, and the whole issue was resolved. And by the way, that's how things should happen today. We should have normal conversations and be able to resolve things. Okay?
But Mark,
let me just say, now to get to your point, but since that point, okay, that issue resolved, we stood for our position. We've had to do similar things at other times and other places in the United States and in the world. But now, you can listen to the phone call or the scripts of our shareholder meetings every year. There's one person who shows up and says, well, I don't understand. Why did you have to go against that law? Do you really think that that's your right as a CEO to fight that law? You know? And I'm like, yes, I have to fight for the rights of our employees. Absolutely. And our customers. That's what I do as a CEO. But yes, there's consequences. You're going to have, if you're going to stand for things, if you're going to focus on your core values, if you are going to look into your heart and decide what is the most important thing to you, and what are you going to do with your business, and what are you going to do with your life, then if you're going to make a decision like that, okay, then you can expect there may be people who are not going to agree with you. And in that case, there are people who want that law who are going to show up and say, hey, I'm, you know, a shareholder and what. Now, that shareholders, they have had tremendous returns, you know, since we made that decision so many years ago. But I have to do what I have to do, what is right and in my heart. And that is what ultimately being a chief executive today is going to be about. Or really just being a human being probably on this planet, you have to follow your heart and follow, you know, what you know is right.
Well, I would suspect, Mark, that what makes Salesforce one of the best places on the planet to work is that commitment more than the kind of food people are getting in the cafeteria. So you should be applauded for that. And I think that's critically important. As we wrap our conversation, because we're going to have some other folks come up and discuss this from different perspective with different brands, I'd love to kind of wrap and say, if we're sitting here in 2050, mm-hmm. where do you think we'll be in this conversation? And does the role of technology enhance? Does it take a backseat? in this transformation, in this commitment to purpose and purpose-driven marketing, it strikes me, as one reporter, it's here to stay. I don't think it's going away. Alan?
I have to declare I'm an optimist. The framework I would use to think about 2050 is what we currently call the Sustainable Development Goals. We'll look back and say, boy, we surprised ourselves on how many of those we achieved in 2030 and the subsequent ones that have been set. Mm. We've got climate control under, we've got control of climate change, 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial. So I think there'll be a lot of positive things happening in the world in CES. I also anticipate that government will by then have looked at business as a force for good and say multilateralism is back. Caring about common good, negotiating across borders, that governments will be inspired by some of the actions that business will have taken. As far as Unilever is concerned, it'll be hard to define what Unilever is. The edges will be much less clear. We'll have many, many more stakeholders involved in the company. And at the center of it, there have been miraculous technological advances that will have helped solve the great problems of our times, but there will be much more difficult ethical dilemmas that we face because of the power of the technology. And so the human gene and the instinct that Mark is describing to do the right thing will become even more important as we drive more and more incredible and awesome technology to solve the big problems in the world. That's how I think CES in 2050 is going to look like.
Mark?
Well, you probably know that I also own Time Magazine. And in December, our team at Time made a decision that made me very proud, which is they made Greta Thunberg the person of the year for 2019. And there's so many reasons why I think that was a great decision and that I fully support them and I'm so excited for their leadership. One is the criticality of focusing on the planet and the planet as a key stakeholder and everyone looking at what they can do to improve the state of the world. But two, also the youth. The youth are the ones who are going to really change the world. You know, that she is a teenager who has created massive change and awareness that she is leading this charge across the planet. I believe there's going to be other members of that organization, that is the youth of the world, who are going to take technology or take the technology we call the fourth industrial revolution, the artificial intelligence, robotics, autonomous vehicles, all of these amazing biotechnologies, CRISPR, genetic engineering, all these amazing technologies that are now at our fingertips. All of these amazing innovations that have really just happened in the last couple decades. The youth of the world, people like Greta Thunberg and others, are going to take these technologies and apply them to transform our world and to make it better. Well, and that is going to be our fifth industrial revolution when we see the youth really do this incredible thing. And so that is really my case for optimism, because I so strongly believe that that is happening now, and as we're going about to see an amazing decade ahead of that further.
What I would say is Greta certainly is an extraordinary example of helping shine a light and bring the awareness. People like the two of you in this moment are the people who can actually help implement those things that are brought to the core. And I would certainly agree with you that the people of Greta's generation will be the ones to do it in the next round, in this fifth revolution. On that note, I want to thank both Mark and Alan for joining us and sharing your insights. You do represent the best there is in purpose and in leading extraordinarily successful and important corporations. So thank you both for joining us today.
I want to repeat my thanks to Alan and Mark for joining me today on stage. It was inspiring to hear about both companies' philosophies on purpose and how they're leveraging technological innovation to make real change today and into the future. Now I'd like to bring out a few very special friends to discuss how media companies, agencies, and brands are interpreting this topic and living their own purpose. Please join me in welcoming Jim Bankoff, the Chairman CEO of Vox Media, Susie Deering, the Chief Marketing Officer of eBay, Julie Loger, the Executive Vice President and President of U.S. Cards for Discover Financial Services, and Tim Mapes, the Senior Vice President and Chief Marketing and Communications Officer of Delta, and finally, Michael Roth, the Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of Interpublic. It's a pleasure to welcome some of you to this stage for the first time and some back for a return visit. I think, Michael, it was about 10 years ago that we shared a stage here at CES. So welcome back, and welcome to those of you who are first-time keynote participants here. Let me start with the word purpose. We used it a lot in the earlier conversation. And as I said, there's no topic that's hotter in 2020. But it's hard to pinpoint sometimes exactly what people mean when they're talking and using that word purpose. Michael, I would start with you at the far end. In your opinion, why is being value-based and purpose-driven good for business? I mean, we heard so much from Mark and Alan, but you've taken so many positions in the industry and in the world at large that were purpose-driven around gender and other things, and I know how committed you are to that. It's good for business, but it's also been good for Interpublic.
Well, yeah, when you think about purpose, you know, it's a reason for being. and corporations have reasons for being. And obviously, as a CEO of a company, you want to set the guidelines in terms of what your objectives are as a company. We set as an objective at IPG that we wanted to be a company that people wanted to work for and clients wanted to do business with. And it's pretty simple to articulate that as a goal. But when we looked at our employee base, it didn't represent the marketplace. It didn't represent the population. So 14 some odd years ago, we decided that we would focus on repositioning and basically changing our workforce to represent the communities that we operate in and the clients and consumers that we're trying to reach. So we made diversity and inclusion a core part of the DNA of our company to a point where we actually held our leadership financially accountable for achieving a diverse workforce, because we're in the marketing and communication business, and how can you represent clients in terms of communicating a message if you don't represent who the consumers are? And so from that day forward, it was part of the DNA of our company. But it led to further looking at the general purpose and social responsibility of our company. And that's when we embraced ESG goals. It was nice to see Alan refer to the strategic development goals of the United Nations. We adopted goal number 6, which has to do with water. And our entire company has embraced that as an objective. And we focused on the work. We're in the marketing and communication business. So actually, Alan and I are vice chair of the Unstereotype organization, which focuses on the work that we produce to make sure that individuals are properly represented in the work. Because if you think about what we do, we all have a responsibility to the marketplace and humanity to represent individuals in a true way. And historically, our industry didn't do that. And so it was imperative that we focus on the kind of work we do and the individuals and how they're portrayed in that work. So it's become a core part of our company. And it was interesting to hear Alan talk about investors. For the first time since I've been doing this, in one of my investor meetings, we had an individual who focused on ESG sitting in the room. And they specifically wanted to know what we were doing as a company in furtherance of ESG. And obviously, we have been addressing that for a while, but it's an indication that all of us, you know, shouldn't shy away from those type of objectives, because the marketplace, the investors, and more importantly, our employees want to work with a company that stands for those propositions. So it's had a tremendous impact on our recruiting and our talent and our retention of our people, and frankly, our client base.
So, Tim, let me hit a controversial topic. Sometime during 2019, Delta Airlines took a position, as I recall, regarding, not a position regarding gun control, but a position regarding the National Rifle Association. To the conversation I was having with Alan and Mark about pushback from shareholders or stakeholders for taking a position that some might, you know, be offended by, find controversial, yet Delta was true to what they felt was important. So two things. A, there's blowback from that sometimes. I'm curious how that impacted you as a company, but also really talk to the fact that there is an opportunity for companies who stake out positions to impact social change by staking out that position and showing the gumption, really, and whatever the position may be, whether we agree with it or not, is not the issue that I'm getting to, although I certainly could, and I would tell you I agreed with it, is if you care, but the fact is there's a risk in that, and yet it does have the ability to impact much bigger footprint than just Delta Airlines. So,
yeah, I mean, I think that's a great example. It was actually March of 2018. It feels like it was last week. Yeah. It was almost 2 years ago. And ironically enough, Mark was one of the first people in social media to applaud our decision for that. The audience might be interested to know, and you were talking about the importance of values and the importance of purpose. Our purpose at Delta centers on serving people and serving humanity. And the value of having clarity with regard to what it is that drives your culture and the types of people you hire, the types of people you want in your culture, that clarity for us is the fact that you can move with great speed. Our assets at Delta Airlines move 525 miles an hour, 35,000 feet above the earth. It's damn important that you know what you stand for in an instance that people's lives are at stake. And when we saw what went on in that instance, and Mark was talking about consequences and implications, there was a $40 million tax loss for us in the state of Georgia as a result of that decision. But it's also worth pointing out that that wasn't popular fully even within our own employee groups. 10% of Delta Airlines comes from the military. You might imagine they have a view with regard to firearms, rightfully. And we're extremely proud of their ability to express those views. In that particular instance, though, we took a stand with great speed around this idea that we're an entity that connects the world and that is about empathy and serving others. And in the instances that we saw with regard to the NRA in that moment and U.S. politicians' reactions and in some ways being, I think, handcuffed by that, we thought it was important that somebody take a stand. It cost us $40 million at the moment. Ed Bastian, our CEO, said almost immediately that our values aren't for sale. And they're not for sale. And that is the value of being clear. Now, does it make everybody happy? No. Did it cost us $40 million? Yes. But we're here 2 years later talking about it. And I would submit as the CMO of Delta that that statement, that moment, that clarity and that ability to move with speed did more for Delta Airlines than any ad, any marketing program, any loyalty in the SkyMiles program, any gesture, any service that we had since then. It was one of the most powerful things we've done, and I think it just reiterates for all of us the importance of having those values, having clarity with regard to that purpose, but most importantly, acting on it with regard, without regard for the consequences.
And to be applauded.
It's nice to be in Las Vegas and not the state of Georgia today, I guess, talking about that.
Susie, one of the things you and I have talked about that is special about eBay is empowerment to the smaller retail opportunities, to the smaller businesses, et cetera, and to the individuals. We've talked about that. That's purpose-driven in and of itself. You're empowering people who would otherwise not have an ability to bring their goods and products and things to market. That's purpose-driven at the core. I mean, that's what one of the things that you shared with me was at the foundation of eBay.
Absolutely.
So, you know, kind of a dangling question, but how does that play out in the real world? You're empowering people on a local basis that would otherwise not have a voice in some way.
Yeah, and it's great, Michael, because I've almost got you to where you know exactly our entire purpose as a company, because it is empowering people and creating economic opportunity. So you're getting really good at it now, so I love that. You know, I think
I listened when you said that to me.
I love it. I love it. You know, I think the important thing when we all talk about purpose, one of the things that comes to mind for me is it's defined by the company, and it has to be defined by the company, by the culture, and by the values. It can't be enforced. And I think that that's a big shift. And for me, I look and go, it's one of the reasons why I'm at eBay, is because when looking at a company and saying, gosh, for the good that they want to do and for the core of who we are, we don't own products. We empower our systems or an ecosystem so that we can ensure that we're empowering small businesses and entrepreneurs and, you know, customers who are looking for other livelihood. And in many cases, we just launched or just passed $1 billion in charitable donations. And the irony is that that's not even necessarily eBay. That's just us giving the technology to all of these different individuals and companies that are making that good, and they're passing that good on into their communities. So even when I think about at the very heart of who eBay is 25 years later, when Pierre started the organization and started or took that first step, he did it with one thing in mind, which I think, gosh, if we could all just wake up with this sentiment every day, which is people are basically good. And how do I make sure that I'm building a company that is in core, doing what's right and in service of, and ensuring that we're creating multiple effects of good? And so when you hear the stories of our sellers, they're unbelievable, because you hear people tell stories about they open up, they start their business on eBay because they're helping feed communities around them. You hear that there's another family that maybe they lost everything and then they have found a livelihood and now they're employing their entire families and they're incredibly, you know, successful. And you look at that and you think, gosh, that's why I get up every day and go to work and make sure that what we're doing is helping those sellers be profitable, but at the same time, be authentically who we are. And so I look at it as it's a blessing in the regard that our purpose is so at the core of who we are. We don't have to make it up, and I don't have to build necessarily unauthentic campaigns to tell that, because it's just naturally
it's
what we stand
your,
for. Absolutely.
Julie, when it comes to innovation, I think it's fair to say Discover's been right at the center. I mean, making people's financial lives easier, lots of different programs that, you know, foundationally are good programs in terms of cashback rewards and kind of putting the consumer at the core, at the center of what you're doing, and thinking of it through that. Even the campaigns that I see on the air now talking about protecting your credit and all of the things that are happening right now and personality theft. What's the word I'm thinking of?
Identity theft.
Thank you. Personality theft. I know whose personality I want to steal. But, you know, those are core principles that are pretty important in terms of doing well and doing good. How does that make its way into the, you know, to the boardroom at a company that is a financial services company?
Yeah, for over three decades, we have driven innovation off the customer. And the customer's been core to who we are and what we stand for, so it's natural, it's part of our DNA. And, you know, we're a financial services company, we're a math company, we have a ton of data. And we like to leverage that data in a way to solve problems for consumers. And one example is free FICO. We innovated that a few years ago, and it ultimately was based on the premise that we receive FICO credit scores on every customer. Why not give it to them for free and educate them and help them improve their lives? And so we took that step one, we took it one step further and started offering a free FICO credit score to anybody 18 and over. And not only did we share the information, but we also shared different ways in which they can improve their score or build their score or rebuild their score.
So there was an educational...
So it was education, it was information to ultimately, you know, better their lives from a financial services perspective. And in today's world, there is just so much financial stress out there across many generations, whether it's millennials who, you know, are more educated than any other generation, yet, you know, over 50% of them are living paycheck to paycheck, or whether it's boomers who, you know, just haven't saved enough, particularly after the financial crisis, to be able, you know, to retire. So a lot of what we do is leveraged off of consumer insights to empower customers to take control and to, you know, improve their daily lives and to have a brighter financial future, which is ultimately the purpose of our company. If we motivate the customer and we motivate the employee, the P&L will be just
fine.
It
drives the bottom line anyway.
It'll be just fine.
I mean, it works. Jim, you've been in technology now for, 120 years.
Since Unilever started.
Exactly. Back with Lord Lever. But you get the opportunity to work with so many different brands. And it's through the brands that are part of your universe. Where do you see the willingness now, or is it obligatory for the brands to really take that purpose-driven stance? Are they doing it because, in your experience, they have to tick a box? And do you see that? And can you sniff that out on the one hand? And, you know, those who are truly committed to it, whatever it may be, that are willing to take a stand and actually back it up with their money, with their movement, with their teams, with their people, et cetera?
I've probably, you know, I'm sitting with some of the best brand marketers in the business. I manage a bunch of really strong media brands. And, you know, our purpose is to inform and engage and entertain, explain the world, a complex world. We do it in serious ways, whether it's helping expose fraud in medical billing or working across the food industry and in other places to expose sexual harassment. But we do it in other ways too, that are more service oriented, whether it's our Eater brand helping you decide where to eat or our Vulture brand helping you decide what TV shows to watch. And then SB Nation, which is a 300 different sports communities convening people. I bring it up to answer your question because there are different ways to serve purpose when you manage a brand. And to answer your question, I think absolutely, if you don't stand for something, you don't stand for anything. And consumers do see that. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean a strident political view. That doesn't necessarily mean meaning nothing to anyone either. It just means, as we just heard articulated here, like, purpose can mean a lot of different things. And I think it's really important that a brand act in the same way a human being would act, to be authentic and to engage with other human beings in a way that is kind of transparent and real, and talks to the values that you not only market, but that you live within your organizations and with your customers. We not only try to do that when we put truth out into the world, but we have a side of our business that helps marketers do that as well. Anyone from the United Nations and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to major brand marketers that are seeking to, you know, tell these stories, because it's a tricky thing to go out there. You don't want to do it in a beating your chest way. No one wants to do it in a way that tries to claim some support, some superiority. But you need to do it in a way that speaks to who you are authentically.
So, Michael, one of the great campaigns of the last decade would be McCann and the work they did with the Fearless Girl. And it was brilliant. And it became something that I think began as a pop-up idea, which became permanent. But then there was blowback. When State Street had some issues, all of a sudden we had that moment where, gee, was this just a marketing campaign that went well, or was this representative of the company? And, you know,
I remember people saying, because that campaign was an award-winning campaign in Cannes and other places, gee, maybe when State Street had their issues, you should take away the awards. I mean, there was an example of a company, and the work that McCann did was brilliant, and yet the company didn't necessarily measure up to what they were standing for, or at least it seemed that way. I don't know all the facts, and, you know, I'm curious how, using that as an example.
Well, that campaign started, to be real honest with you, it wasn't a girl initially, it was a cow. But that's a detail I probably shouldn't put out there. But the intent of the campaign was the launch of a women's-owned investment fund, a mutual fund that they were launching. So the notion of the fearless girl down on Wall Street facing the bull was the genesis and related to the purpose of the fund that it represented. And it just took off all over the world. And it makes the point that what we do in this business has a dramatic impact on society. And it goes beyond. Obviously, it did a lot in terms of the brand State Street, and the effect of that was significant. But it really emphasizes the importance of what we do as an industry and how we can change lives and we can have an impact in the marketplace. And I think it's a great example. And, you know, I remember when we started out doing those kind of campaigns, you know, purpose-driven campaigns and so on. Now, it's proven fact that companies that do those type of campaigns develop a loyalty with their consumers. And it's a loyalty. Consumers want to do business with companies that stand for the values that they have. And they will, in fact, move from one brand to another because of that. So now when we focus on work and we want to build brands, we focus on how does that relationship develop and what can we do with our brands to develop it and have that trust factor with the brand. And we have this year, for example, we had another award campaign with IKEA working with the furniture. And on disability, individuals had trouble with the furniture in terms of it wasn't constructed to recognize physical disabilities. So we came up with a campaign with a simple idea of adding some additional pieces of wood or whatever to make the furniture accessible to people with disabilities. And it had a tremendous lift in terms of business. The reputation of IKEA had 2 billion views in terms of the work that was done. So that type of relationship in the marketplace is invaluable. And it's within all of our organizations to develop that type of work and that type of creativity that relates to the consumer and our products. So I think that's the future of our business. I can talk all day about some of the stuff that we do, but I think that is what you really want to do when you launch a campaign and develop a relationship with the consumer. Show what the company and what the brand stands for. It develops trust, and you know, when you're competing in the world of the internet, if you will, brands, it's not just the lowest price, it's the value of the brand. And when you do that, you have a winning formula.
One of my favorite quotes from Oscar Wilde was that definition of a cynic was the person who knew the price of everything, excuse me, and the value of nothing. So if you take a cynical approach to that, you know, on a positive side, I think you're right. Tim, you've talked a lot about the concept of branding from the inside out, beginning with your employees, kind of what we were talking about with Mark and Alan, but you've, again, done a great deal of work in that space. And your product, obviously, is the ability to get people from one place to another, but it's the people who do it that are where we're interacting. We don't interact with the plane. I mean, we do, but we interact with the people on the plane more than anything else. Instilling those values from the inside out, How's that translated for you in terms of the Delta brand and what it stands for?
I was really favorably impressed with Mark's comments earlier about all constituencies, not just shareholders. That's certainly the way we think of it at Delta. As you might imagine, if you have frontline employees who serve each of you on any given day, who operate the aircraft or who board the planes, take your reservation or what have you, and they're worried about their mortgage or they're worried about their family or their dog or their kid's college or any number of maladies that afflict humanity that we all deal with every single day, then their mind is on that, and it's not on the safe operation of the aircraft or the on-time reliability of your flight or ideally ensuring that you have a memorable experience on us. And there was a great spot years ago about the happy cows of California making better cheese or better dairy products, and I'll stay with the cow metaphor, I guess, but it holds true in service business. You cannot have great customer service if you have distracted or, God forbid, unhappy or disenfranchised employees. So branding from the inside out for us starts with that whole idea of the nobility of service that I mentioned. We attract, we retain, we inspire, we incent the types of people for whom service is noble, which is unfortunately increasingly rare in our society, and it's increasingly rare in this country. Other countries do a very good job, frankly, of having a sense of nobility of serving others. Americans look to be served. I think increasingly we find it among first responders, among educators, among people who do have military backgrounds. There's a selflessness to them. They make fantastic Delta employees, and they're the types of people who come with that embedded idea that I'm here to help you, I'm here to serve you and others. And those people are increasingly rare in our world, and when we find them, we want to incent them quickly. We're in the process. We just closed 2019. It'll be the fifth year in a row that we provide profit sharing of over $1 billion to our employees to ensure that our employees, when they're serving you, are focused on you, not their mortgage, not their kids' college, and other things like that.
Julie, one of the challenges that we face is no company can do this alone. And we saw the example of Salesforce and Unilever, who have worked together as true partners. It's kind of a group effort for people to deliver on these promises. Where do you find that opportunity most? And how does that manifest itself? You know, we can all come to conferences and interact with peers and talk about these things. You know, you work with so many different companies as a financial partner. Do you pick and choose based on that?
You know, we pick and choose based on, you know, the type of company we are, our values, and our purpose. I'll give two examples. One is we're known for cashback bonus as a credit card company. We're the first ones to innovate it. And we give out, you know, on an annual basis over $2 billion. So when there's a natural disaster out there, we make it a point to tell our 25 million plus customers to say, hey, if you want to give to American Red Cross during this natural disaster, this is the way that you can do it. We'll make it really easy. We do it through mobile device, online, obviously, and it's a way for them to donate their cashback bonus to help a particular cause. We likewise will match whatever is donated. So that's one thing that we'll partner from a volunteerism perspective. I would say from, you know, going into 2020, we're developing quite a few partnerships, you know, again, in a way to elevate our purpose and our focus on really pushing the brighter financial future value proposition. And that one example is with Arianna Huffington. She has a pretty big site out there, and we're going to be announcing a partnership soon, and it's all around wellness. So we'll be an exclusive partner in the financial wellness area. And the other one that we're really proud of is Quibi. So we're one of the 10 partners that with Quibi. And again, it's a platform that we'll be able to market our and communicate to, you know, the younger generation what we stand for and the products and services that we can offer.
I do want to share a story as we wrap today, but it's a Quibi story. And tomorrow there'll be an opportunity for Jeffrey and Meg to demonstrate Quibi and see some of what they're going to deliver in April. But this is firsthand. I happen to know about a project that they greenlit. I had a familial connection to it. And in the script, it called for the characters to be smoking, and they were teenagers. And Quibi's position on it was, there must be another way to communicate that muscle. We don't want to portray children smoke. And I take my hat off, and I think it's something to be applauded, because that says, it happened to be Jeffrey communicating it, but I'm certain Meg is on point with it, that speaks to exactly what you're saying, that they were willing to say, no, you can rewrite that portion of the script and communicate that same message without shining any positive light on kids smoking. So to your point, it's a nice way to give a little shout out for our friends at Quibi tomorrow, but I appreciate that. Susie, I want to ask you and Jim the same question I asked Alan and Mark, but I want to bring it a little closer than 2050, because you guys are younger, so you know, no. 2030.
Okay.
No, I see, I didn't do what you thought I would, Susie. I didn't go there, but it's 2030. It's 10 years from now. What's different? What do you see as technology enabling any of the things we're talking about today?
You know, I think that I think Mark was right on point in the sense that we're going to watch like another massive, I think, more implementation of the things that we're building or talking about today. What I actually maybe would take the shift of saying technology, and I also think all the points on technology being, you know, used for good is dead on. I would argue that, you know, they made the points about, you know, there's many things. Our words can be used for good or bad. So you can think about anything in that regard. But when I look forward and I see what technology is able to do right now, and we see this convergence of where people want to do more and do good in our environment and do more and good for each other, and I've got to believe that that's just going to continue because of the generation that's coming in, watching how badly we've failed at it in many regards. And I don't look at that and say that's shame on us. I think that it's just part of the evolution and process of this. And I think that what's going to happen is all of those things are going to start to come together. Instead of us sitting up here on a panel talking about it, they're going to actually be able to show where that good is happening. I think you use the terminology all the time about like your feet and your hands, you know, that show that versus just the voice of it. And I think that's ultimately what we're going to see happen. And that is, I think, extremely exciting because we're going to be able to watch all these things that we've, you know, kind of challenged ourselves with, like don't know what to do with the technology, need to figure out how do we implement it, and then we're going to see it start to really take shape and deliver on what we believe ultimately can be good about it.
So Jim, I want to end with you, and you know, you're in a business that could arguably be characterized as news. I mean, that's your business to a great degree, and it's a business that is under challenge today more than any time in my lifetime, certainly. And it goes back to what Mark was talking about with truth. We're dealing in a situation in a world today where you don't kind of know who to believe anymore. You don't know which side, and I hate to look at it that way, but you have to, which side is actually telling the truth. You know, this concept, I don't even want to use the two words together, but one starts with an F and one starts with an N. I don't even want to say it because I don't want to give credence to it. But you're in that world where people have to trust you.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you chose to end on this. And I, you know, to bring the two questions together, how is technology changing production, consumption of news and entertainment more broadly? There is, and it's an amazing time. We talked about Quibi, whether we look at Quibi, Netflix. We're going to launch with several Quibi shows. We have a great hit show on Netflix called Explain that we're proud of. These are all new platforms for us to program. Our company was only born 10 years ago, and we're able to reach hundreds of millions of people already because of the explosion of digital technologies. And we're proud of that, whether it's podcasting, OTT platforms, good old-fashioned websites, what have you. Not only us, but it's a great opportunity for diversity of voices out there. So that's wonderful. It's never been a better time to be a consumer of media products. But along with that comes great responsibility. And you asked about purpose. That's the theme here. And purpose for us is a healthy and sustainable news media and media ecosystem. And technology can play a role in that. I think technology has, as the previous panelists talked about, it could be good or it could be bad. I think we've seen a lot of, in addition to the good things I just mentioned, a lot of bad things, particularly with the major platforms of discovery, the social platforms in particular. Search is another thing, and I think we're starting to see some commitment, not only to truth and accuracy and some distillation between what is real and what is fake. The platforms have responsibilities, companies like ours have responsibilities, and consumers over time have to educate themselves and build awareness of the media they're consuming as well, and literacy around that. Technology can help them do that. Another place is around data integrity and privacy. We launched an initiative called Forte that seeks to not invade your privacy, but still use data in terms of the signals that we're getting based on content as opposed to your individual behavior, to allow marketers to target, but to target in a way that doesn't dig into people's personal lives. And that's another way technology has to change to support the news media business. And ultimately, not only around the FN issues that you related, but there's an existential issue out there as to how news media companies are going to support themselves financially. And I'm proud to say that, you know, we're able to do that. We're a growing and profitable company. And we're committed not only to doing that for ourselves, but to helping to do that for the rest of the industry by some of the technologies that we've used to scale. We're now making available to the entire industry products like Chorus, which is a media publishing platform, or Concert, which enables premium advertising at scale. So, but it's not just the technologies that we develop. It's about this industry coming together to solve problems for audiences and to be stronger business. And I'm actually extraordinarily optimistic that as we enter this year, that all of the disruption that has changed the industry is going to not only benefit consumers, but start to accrue back to the industry, and we're going to have stronger opportunity to grow and serve our audiences.
Well, what I would like to end on is there's nothing fake about having Interpublic, Delta, eBay, Discover, Vox, Unilever, and Salesforce talking about purpose and being real about it. So I want to thank all of you for joining us today. And thank you.
I'll tell you a story.